way over on the top side. And it's like, no, we're just coming to the river. Mm-hmm. Now you're spread out. Now we've pinched you off. Now here's the time for the divide and conquer. And we are now into the game. Welcome everybody here to FlyQuest versus Immortals game two. If you missed it, FlyQuest took game one in a fairly close match, but Moon and Altech did beautifully. Coordination was solid. Immortals gonna hope to get a little bit more out of their bot lane, but they are a good enough team to win as we get into picks and bans.
Right.
Early standard blue side, no Kha'Zix allowed for Dardock, no surprise.
And aside from the obvious of prioritizing your bottom lane picks, you can alleviate some of that pressure by denying things like the Shen that are gonna be used probably around that bottom side of the map, because that is another factor. I wouldn't go so far as to say, oh, you need to ban Moon's Evelynn or anything, because gank pressure is always a thing in the bottom lane, no matter what champion it's on. And I don't feel like that one's a super high priority or anything, but especially since FlyQuest have just gone back to Shen over and over, and actually, they're showing right now that they have the highest priority on that champion nab him up again. Bear in mind that this time as well, they also spent a ban towards the top side, towards Maokai, to eliminate that advantage of team fighting that we kind of went over. Immortals, if they had played more defensively and maybe had been able to limit the bleeding, would eventually be able to rely on Maokai, better tank in the 5-on-5 standup, but that won't be an option this time around. So maybe it is on Immortals going for some flashy stuff here. I actually really hope, yes, they lock in the Lee Sin for Dardock.
Yeah. And I want to see Jace in for Flame as well. I feel like if Immortals' best performing players, there we go, is their top side of the map. I feel like you put your eggs in the Flame basket, you boil them up, and you hope that you can actually win some games through top lane.
Okay, if you are drafting this, you need to snowball early. You need to keep up the pressure. Jace has to be pushing turrets non-stop. He's got a Lee Sin at his back to help him out with aggressive plays. You want to whittle down the Shen, try and get him low health, maybe open up dive, maybe at least keep pressure up there, because if you don't start getting the early turret gold to help you snowball through the mid game, then you will fall off, or you will fall prey to the cross map plays, because Evelynn and Shen are going to be doing a very similar thing. Jhin again, so they'll probably focus on the bottom side. Altec will jump out to the early lethality build.
Yep.
This time around though, that is important for Cody Sun to be able to actually have a comparable AD carry down there as far as the ramping goes.
Yeah, and I want to see if they can just, get a decent wave clear bot lane in there. They can just kind of shove up and shove up and just, not ever really be under major threat, because that was the issue before. And right, you have a very obvious Immortals game plan of trying to pressure for topside, I would expect. And FlyQuest, if they can keep the bot lane pressure going, I think that can be stymied somewhat by proper champs like from Immortals. We'll see. Cassiopeia off the table means two teamfight mid laners have already been banned away on the side of FlyQuest, Ryze earlier on in the ban phase.
And I would actually expect Immortals to just really keep on going with this. Try and draft a super strong mid lane as well, pushing maybe a Corki to go along with that poke, add that magic damage from the mid lane, because you really do want to get the early tempo and keep it. And Corki is definitely a great champion to do that. Plus, Haya has just gone back to that champion over and over and over again and definitely shown that willingness.
Yeah, well, they do need magic damage out of the mid lane. The rest of their team comp's already physical damage for Immortals. So first pick, Corki, maybe on the table. Syndra dropped off. And of course, now it's Immortals' time to resume picks here. Actually, Morgana, the support pickup, is going to be the grab. So not knowing what the support is of FlyQuest, they're going to grab Morgana here. Technically could flex mid, though I doubt it highly.
Yeah.
Oh, they're going to play one of his very standard champions down here.
Yep, his most played and will continue to be his most played. We'll be fishing for those bindings. Yeah, you can set up Varus to land some extra damage as well. The bindings and the Varus ultimate can combine for a lot of lockdown if you're able to snare someone and turn that around. It also means you can pull off some pretty good counter ganks sometimes. Luckily for Evelynn, Moon will have extra speed to try and dodge those bindings. Evelynn's W is really invaluable when you're ganking a lane like that, but you have to be sure to sidestep those, because if you get locked up, they can easily take you down.
So blind pick Zed coming out of high, and keep in mind, Immortals are still allowing Jace to be a flex pick because they haven't shown their true mid laner yet. And in case Bulwether was thinking about playing Jace in the mid lane, I don't feel like that'd be good into Zed all that easily.
The only, flex I do see would be a Rumble top, because it's good into Shen, and you really need some magic damage on this team. So even though they're only mousing over it this time, expect the lock-in. They are able to pick that one up. So it's going to be the flex into the Shen to try and get that good matchup still. Even though it's not the Jace, it's still going to be a similar strategy. They're going to have some aggressive solo lanes here, an aggressive jungler, definitely. And Darduk, huge highlight plays from him on Lee Sin, definitely one of his favorite champions. And we'll see if he can perform with it here, because he could definitely change the way this entire game goes. If the bottom lane on Morgana and Varus is able to wave clear, as you said, just kind of trade CS, the solo lanes are really set up to help him out. And Evelynn versus Lee Sin is very good if Lee Sin is able to get a bead on her, as long as she doesn't, you know, dodge out your Q. And even sometimes if she does dodge out your Q early on.
You never know. Well, FlyQuest have changed exactly one champion between game one and two. A new mid laner in high, picking up Zed instead of Corki. But Immortals, five new champions here, completely revamping the champs, like hoping that a new look for the squad can work out. They are playing a carry top for Flame instead of that tank Maokai, so we may see that pressure up there start paying dividends if Immortals can keep their bot lane afloat this time around, or if Moon can still just capitalize on that and just feast on those players.
Yeah. I mean, you can't be everywhere at once, right? So you need to identify, for Immortals, they probably want to play around topside. The top triangle, basically, of jungle, you know, top laner and mid laner should be where they're trying to create a lot of their plays, considering both of those lanes are a bit volatile. Even though they're hugely bully lanes, they can also, if they do get ganked, it's rough if they, you know, get killed early on and blow summoners.
So here we are, game two, maybe the decider, as FlyQuest once again takes to the Rift to take on Immortals, hoping for some more volatile lanes, as Kobe put it. Flame playing Rumble in the top lane, synergy bonus there, you've got to expect, and Poe Belter on the Jason mid, hoping this one can tilt in their favor with Darduk on the playmaking. Lee Sin grabbed that one in the first round. Moon back on his characteristic Evelynn, finally found a win on it over in the first game of this series. Previously lost both his matches, or games, against Echo Fox, playing that champ despite playing well himself. And FlyQuest hoping to make it a 2-0.
Yeah, I think this is a really intelligent invade here from Immortals, because the jungle is going to be, you know, a big part of it, and Darduk wants this control. I would expect them to drop off a ward before they leave, so they can see where Moon is starting, and, you know, he can start to get to work in that sort of top triangle. Because remember, yeah, Jace, you know, does have range advantage on Zed, and if Jace is good at dodging the first, you know, set of Qs, Zed loses a lot of pressure in that lane. But if you get ganked and you die in that lane, and Zed gets up to that level 6 earlier, then you really do have to be wary, because you can still go for those all-ins. You can tell in the summer spells, though, they're prepared for this. Poe Belter with the exhaust, high with the ignite.
And, yep.
They're going to have to be fairly careful.
Like that quick aggressive trinket out from Moon. Spots that Flame is leeching for Darduk to the top side. No surprise, but it's always good to have it securely known. Moon once again doing the Raptors start that he did in the prior game, so no leash at all, but you can see lots of bonus XP for him.
Yeah, and Evelynn is definitely one of the champions that it is nice to do that on. As we said, at the start of the game, you do get extra bonus experience for the low level of all those Raptors. And Evelynn has AoE at level 1 with her Q spam. So able to do it fairly healthy. Only one charge on the potion used. And always take Talisman on Evelynn, because you can get so much health stealing out of that.
Yep, AoE the whole wave.
One of my favorite picks, actually, is even if you, later on in the game, don't want to kill the Raptor camp,
just
you can pass by it. You gain 100 to 150 health off of just passing by it, landing Qs as you're running. It still leeches the health, even though you know, you're walking away.
Absolutely. Flame UNC looks for the aggressive trinket ward. Will actually see Moon, didn't turn invisible yet, so they know what's up with this Evelynn.
Yeah, the cooldown on your pass is pretty long early on.
Yeah.
But regardless, you rarely run into mana problems, because you can just walk around invisible for the extra regen later. Darduk, meanwhile, now that he has that extra information afforded to him by Flame, can make his way, actually, wherever he wants, go control the scuttles, even go for an invade on Moon. Evelynn has to be super scared, as I said, about any confrontations with Lee Sin,
nice,
as he will easily outduel her, unless the circumstances are heavily changed by laners.
And this is really well played by Immortals. This is one of the benefits of having a best of three and having your coaches sit in the back room. This same jungle start for Moon in this one They pinged with him doing Raptors at level one, and they pinged him doing Wolves. They warded him doing Blue, and it's an easy red steal.
Also, Darduk could definitely wait around and get a huge chunk out of Moon's health. Level three Evelynn is a good target, but
Moon misses a flash. E dead. Oh, gets a Q out of the wall anyway. Bobalter, maybe not the best flash. Darduk minions in first blood. That is a catastrophe that should have been first blood. And now Pobo just missing his flash. Exhaust is on. Damage output here. Gets him into the wall, though. They've got to be a bit careful. But here comes Shen, and that's going to be the kill picked up anyway. 2-0 FlyQuest. And that's got to feel terrible for Immortals.
Oh, shoot.
There you go. PG-13.
That
sucks.
That definitely sucks for Immortals. That's almost like the whole spirit for their whole team has just kind of been crushed here. We talk about how much this lane can snowball the other way as well. Your Lee Sin that has this huge advantage over Evelynn, could wait at the buff to try and chunk him out when he comes to check it. Goes for the gank onto High. High gets double buffs. He gets the kill. He gets the flash as well. Both flashes were used. It just so much in the favor of FlyQuest off of that early play. Early botched play from Immortals. That is really a demoralizing start. So one of the big things now, as a team, it's still so early on in the game. Mm-hmm. Even though it's rough, you got to find a way, you know, to change focus and really reset the mentality, because the mid lane is really going to be High's favor, and that just bailed Moon out, right?
Yeah, it really did.
Darduk was going to have a huge early lead and a large amount of time advantage, but now Moon's actually got a level advantage, and he's got his Hunter's Potion and armor already
set
up for defensive play.
And this is kind of like the mark of a good Evelynn player. He's like, okay, I know Lee Sin's going to want to live in my jungle. I know Darduk's aggressive. I'll go Hunter's Potion for full HP all the time, and I'll go Cloth Armor so I don't get one shot. It'll delay his power spikes, absolutely, but Pobalter's going to face check into him, and that's good enough. And out goes Pobalter. He's going to maybe recall away from this.
I will say that props to Pobalter, though. As soon as he got close to that bush, he was watching High the whole time he moved towards the bush.
Mm-hmm.
And you can tell from your enemy's movements. As soon as he moved towards it, High moved up aggressively in the lane. He's like, oh, God, Evelynn is definitely here. Now, this is the type of game sense that we were talking about in game one that the bottom lane maybe should
have
taken into account. But Pobalter, even though he gets chunked there, he's forced back and he's in a terrible situation. At least he did have that game sense to see High moving up and not get himself killed.
2-on-2 fight for the Scuttle Crab. Boop. Good smite by Moon, grabs it away. More camps out, good dodge in the Dark Binding as well. High just under the turret, he's level 6 and baits out to the skies.
Exhaust
drops turret aggro, good damage. One more hit would kill him, but he can't get back into range. Pobalter stay is alive, but only barely.
Whew. Yeah, holding on there just barely, and this is maybe the third time in the last minute that Pobalter has had to base. Is really suffering an experience now, and it's just going to get worse. Now he does not have exhaust. Exhaust is the only thing deterring High from doing that again. Now it will not be there, and High will have Ignite for next time.
Mm-hmm.
It's all about cooldown tracking, and High will have shorter cooldowns.
It's going to be a huge advantage, I got to say. High is going to feel pretty good about this one. Flame is level 6, does have Teleport, does have Equalizer, even as Haunting Guy. So first Power Spike secured for Rumble. He reached level 6. Maybe Immortals can make a play out of this one. There was temporarily a minion lead in the bot lane. That has gone away now. Cody's Son actually does have better items overall in the lane. His inventory's a bit richer. Might not mean much, though.
Yeah. Hey, lands an arrow there, at least. I'll take it to level 6, though, and you got to be careful. We did say what we want from this bottom lane, though, was to try and trade CS and their wave clearing and doing that at
fine.
The moment. So even though tragedy struck in the mid lane, need to try and stay upbeat about it and try and get back here.
And no game's over just because it's 2-0.
Exactly. It's only 1,000 gold. It just seems so scary. And you really feel for Pobalter in that lane. Facing is dead. That his ultimate's about to come back up. Its Ignite is about to come back up. Bottom lane gets pelted here with a long-range harass.
That's just
boned off the experience.
Yeah, and it's like, we're level 6. Run away from your turret. So they do. Shoot Ole again. 140 HP down and miss a couple of melee minions. 10 CS overall denied. Make that 8, but still advantage, of course, to FlyQuest. Sometimes I want to say FlyTech. I don't know why. I guess it goes to Altech. Slide right over it.
Give you a pass on that one.
All right.
Moon continuing to farm here on a ward. Hasn't had to do anything. Feels good.
Yep.
Hein's going for it. Pretty much on cooldown there for the ultimate. Gets a large chunk of health. Mm-hmm. Does not burn the ignite as he did not expect to grab that kill. And holds on to the longer cooldown.
Yeah. And I actually like how Povolter is playing it. It seems, yeah. I'm pretty sure the way it works is you always show up behind your target. So as long as Pov is somewhere near his own turret, you just melee form, hammer him backwards, and Zed will take turret aggro, and Hai can't fight for much longer. So as long as Povolter's not like in the middle of the lane, he can make these trades very short.
It's one of the interesting things that was always cool about the Ahri matchup with Zed Ahri, because you try and charm backwards immediately to the other side that he starts his ultimate from. But yeah, similar thing there with Jace.
This one's targeted. You're just going to mash your keyboard and it's going to work out for you in the end. But less timing requirement, more just make sure you do it in time.
Also, a little bit less reward. The charm landing is huge in the matchup. But Popelter is trying to hold on here in the mid lane. He's doing just that. At least hasn't had a huge CS deficit balloon here. So I have to say, you know, making the best of that bad situation, stabilizing their mental game, you know, calming down the shot calling here for Immortals. Has happened. The thing now, though, is that FlyQuest are the ones with the initiative. They've got the Shen ult ready. They have the Jhin who's powered up and started roaming around now. That it really is their next move to make. And Immortals' really hope here is to try and come up with a good counterplay. You know, Zardoz getting in place for a counter gank and trying to burst somebody out.
Okay, we'll see what happens right here.
A lot of mid lane focus.
Yeah, a bit of commotion. Let's see, here we go, looking for Hai. Jumps over towards Ole. Shen's in there as well. That's a bad news bears for Morgana. One kill picked up. Is there more to be had? Whiff, equalizer turns into nothing right there.
Ult is low.
Back in a ball. Taunt comes off on a Zard. Not going to land the root just yet, but a double kill comes through anyway for Zed. Falls. Does fall off. One picked up the Cody's son, but Powalter is going to be chopped down to the side. 5-1 sum in the scoreline. FlyQuest pick up a 3-1 fight.
That is one of the cases where sometimes bringing too many people to a gank gives away your position, because there were no wards for FlyQuest on top side. Three members top side might have been able to get the jump on Hai, but Olay coming up from the bottom side river over wards was just too juicy. That draws all of FlyQuest not only to Olay, but away from the rest of the threat from Immortals that's on the top side here. See, Olay comes up, they're like, oh, juicy target. We just jump on him, you know, free kill. That not only was a pretty free kill, but also drew them away from this threat that Immortals had set up on the other side. And that kind of allowed the advantage here for FlyQuest, as the bottom lane did arrive pretty quickly here, and Cody-san made his way up, but Altec opens up on Jhin and is able to land that last one to secure the kill on Jace as well. And the lead does balloon that way.
Look at that, 4-0-1 on Hai. The attention is all centered around him. He's done a pretty good job of navigating through it. Still got to worry about that heartbreak of a first blood, or, you know, elation if you're FlyQuest, of course. But it's quickly slipping out of Immortals' hands. And this one, you can't blame the bot lane for it. Cody-san is their only kill. This time it was Zardoz and Popelter who just overstepped and got 2-0 to level 3.
I mean, we can revel in this a little bit. Hai styling on Zed once again.
Yeah.
It's been years. They see Zardoz on the ward. Doesn't care about it.
Doesn't matter. Goodbye. Poppy goes.
And they get the assist because Karma added the shield speed.
Gave him some move speed.
There you go.
Elimination, equal participant in that fight, deserves the share of wealth somewhat. But yeah, Hai is now too far ahead to matter.
Again, the focus though, right? They call over Altec and Elimination to just shove this advantage right down Immortal's throat. They grab another turret super quickly with it, and that's the way that they blow open these games. They just take a hold of that advantage lane and press it all the way home. Hai, just the classic stretch now. I'm just so used to him. Every time he gets solo kills in the mid lane, it's the
just puts out his wings.
It reminds me of the Inori Rengar.
Oh,
one.
Yeah.
But he's got his own flavor here, the FlyQuest version of it for Hai. 5 now kills for him, and the lethality will just keep on stacking from this point. It just gets worse and worse. Everybody on the enemy team is a prime target, by the way. There is nobody
safe.
The duo of ninjas, really, because Balls, even if someone was semi-safe, Balls can just come and and help out high with a Stand United just to add some extra safety there as well.
You know what's actually kind of funny? It's a team with two ninjas, and there's someone else that turns invisible. Yeah. Like, you feel like thematically invisibility be one of the other two, but nope. Moon, maybe the true ninja in this game, who knows? Either way, it's FlyQuest off to a great early lead. Cloud Drake, why not?
All right, well.
Little dangerous from Altec. Yeah. I mean, he got rooted anyway, but here comes the attack into the back line. High does not get away from the chains. Will it even matter, though? 4v2.
Good shots. I mean, they're trying to fend him off from all sides.
Yeah.
Cody Sun and Ole firing at everyone. Ah, get away from me! No!
They're all going to die. And somehow High steals both kills. I don't know how, but he got the kill credit. He gets the 7-0-1 scoreline. First turret still. Nah, that was a while ago, but at least Immortals knocked down top outer. That was Flame's prerogative. He was winning the lane for a while. Volusia kites away and says, yeah, no, they're diving me. I'm just going to back off here.
Falls has been happy to take up the Shen, or when on the rare case that's banned out or picked away, he has opted for the other tanks as well. Maokai doing a little bit of his time as well. He just takes that small CS difference and then becomes such a big part of the team fights.
Looks like another turret in the works. Ole's here. Misses the bind pretty hard, but takes a bit of damage and walks away. Look at that, 4 turrets to 1 now, the score line. I mean, very close to a perfect game.
Oh, Flame has something to say about it.
Shen's gonna show up on an all deck elimination. Like, ooh, I wish I weren't here right now. My health bar is running pretty low. Shock Blast just barely flashed away. Oh. Electro Harpoon, number 2. Summoner Heal comes in, and now he's slowed down, rooted in place, and it's gonna get a lot worse before it gets a lot better. High zoning out the back line. Ole, 1 hit away from Dead Moon, running for dear life. Flame does get a kill on an all deck. That's something to be happy about. Still chasing in, can't get any more. Looks like 2-1 overall in favor of FlyQuest on that fight. Could have been worse, could have been better.
True. True statement.
Useful statement.
I feel like you can say that about literally anything. Here we go. Can't be worse.
Yeah. Sure, whatever.
Here goes Flame, though. Does go for the flash follow on Lemonation. Lemon is zigzagging, avoids the harpoon, and gets turned around on a Flame. As he said, though, charges all tech, and he's going to gank someone down with him. The ultimate there, and they at least do get that one kill, but that is about it that they get out of it here. Hey!
Oh, ooh! Ooh,
opa!
Back in!
Hey!
You're 1v3 high,
wait
but
a second.
That's a little suicidal.
You're not that good, high.
That's a little suicidal. Quick chains come up with Cody Sun.
He wanted to outplay the three man.
I know.
There. That was reaching a little bit, but
that was a blooper reel play right there.
It's all right. He almost got his ultimate. What he was looking for there, by the way, is ultimate, so you go untargetable, and then he was gonna jump back, but gets hit with the quick ulti from Cody Sun.
Yeah.
So some credit to Cody Sun there.
I like how we're giving High credit for dying for free. We're like, hey, he was looking for a good play. You know, I understand why he wanted to do it. That was a bit too much style. I'm sorry, Kobe.
You have to explain the thought process, freak. That's
I know. I'm mostly giving you crap. It turned out the way it did. Cody Sun, quick reflex on the R. Was very important. He would have probably died if he hadn't done that. And now High, back on the map, looking for Mercurial Scimitar, I'm guessing. What this item's turned into, who knows? Maybe it's Hexdrinker and a Ruin King. Maybe it's Merc Treads and a Ruin King. It's something.
Green Wild.
Walk right back
up. It's
going
to be an Infernal Drake as well. Huge snowball here for FlyQuest. Things have gotten a little bit chaotic as the entire map is open a lot earlier than usual.
Yeah, they just flashed open the map. It's 5 turret kills in 17 minutes. That's quicker than almost any game. And now when they go for this bright red Drake, 1,000 HP left, not even a chance. And Moon practices his Smite secures and gets that no problem. Moon actually going for a tankier build, by the way. Checking in, Iceborne Gauntlet picked up quickly to be an extra frontliner. He's not snowballing, so he's going to go for the utility style, which is interesting, but looks like it'll work for him.
I mean, some extra armor, no problems here. You can build whatever you want, honestly. Every member of FlyQuest is incredibly rich.
Well, looking for Flame, does not have a zone, he's completed, so one more shot will do it. Oh, it goes wide, but the Ignite is enough high. Flame's another piece for his collection. Wrong assassin, still
Meanwhile,
counts.
Meanwhile, Ball's in the side lanes, slowly working away at those minions. He's ready to come in at any moment. Immortal Shield with the chase might actually prompt that. Whoop. Not gonna commit, though.
Go to the red team. FlyQuest happy to get their one kill, looks like they'll back out. The jungle on the top side of the map is cleared of monsters to kill. Bot side has a few things there, and looks like Moon's gonna go grab some more golden experience for himself. is worth pointing out, really, at all tiers of play. It's pretty vital to keep your jungle clear. It's a significant source of gold and experience that, like, minions are going to be there and you can just show up and collect them, but until you kill the monsters, they won't respawn. You're just missing out on potential gold that your team could gain. It is actually a somewhat valuable objective. Just full clearing your jungle is worth, like, two kills.
Honestly, Immortals here just looking to pick up scraps.
Fight for the blue! And it's gonna go to Moon! Root's gonna land on Darduk as well, and Agony's Embrace buys a few seconds, but...
buys a few seconds?
I mean, maybe they can catch up to Darduk, and it's not. They can't. They needed more than that. They needed thirds or fourths.
Oh, dodge the Shock Blast, and change my mind. I don't want that 1v1.
Whoop, goes in anyway. Tanks the two disguise, but there's a Shen coming in as well. Po Belzer. Nice taunt, and pop, down he goes once again.
No fair, 2v1.
0-5-1.
Classic ninjas cheating again.
But see, here's the weird thing, though. The law of inverse ninja power says if there's more ninjas, they're weaker. And yet with two, they won.
It used to be they get -1 health for every other ninja in the game.
Did you know it used to be -1 attack?
Right, yeah,
way
even,
back
even
when?
Before. Yeah. But alas, they took both of those out.
And, did they actually? I didn't know
they
that.
They did.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's fair. It's probably smart, too. Did you know if you're wearing sunglasses, you take one less damage from Fiona's pass?
I think it was because people would just rage if they died by one health, and they were like, that's a ridiculous flavor balance. That's,
not worth the gain. Darduk jumps to a minion, turns on the spell vamp, and just runs away, licking his wounds. Bind on elimination. Ole gets the better of that one.
Yeah. Pretty classic here, though. They have a huge gold lead to work with, so just go to your 1-3-1 with your dual ninjas flanking on each side of the map, and your invisible whatever Evelynn is roaming around trying to pick
Shadow Demon
in the middle,
or Succubus, or I don't know.
I feel
he's getting a rework eventually.
Succubus sounds right. The right one. Look at him. He's actually flanking around. Just this is a classic super fed Evelynn play. You're just up in enemy territory, looking around for any stragglers.
Yep.
Who wants
Same
to
as
die?
Me. I actually know what Evelynn's supposed to be. I'm not going to spoil it, though, but I've heard. Inside Riot information.
That's just cruel. Why are you just like, I know something. Ooh,
I know something
so
you
cool.
don't know. That
Good
that,
one, Freak.
Yeah. I like thinking people dislike me. It's my new thing.
You don't have to try.
Fair point.
Woo! Yeah, there we go.
Kobe 1, Freak 0.
Classic NA jungler flame.
Yeah.
All right, here we go, though. Go for the...
Indoor's going to clean you up. Oh, he's not fast enough. He's got boots 1. He's just too slow.
Can he dodge out, though?
Look for Darduk. Dodge away from the shock. But suddenly, there's more team here. That was a bait in the first place. High flashing away from everything else. Darduk nearly dead. Does limp away barely. And the last curtain call not going to land either. So out they go. Nothing for nothing. Ole gets the wards back down.
Well, after that bit of excitement, maybe we'll see them focus on Baron to actually finish the game out. It's like so. Here comes the Stan United. Now, this does open up the opportunity for Immortals to try and get a steal.
Nice. Dead, if not for that shield. Yeah, that was... I love the aggressive play. And, Flame did burn TP to get in there.
Let's count the things, you know, in Immortals' favor. The Immortals' flavor for stalling out is Shock Blast and Arrow Spam from Varus. Two of the best for, you know, firing projectiles over the Baron Pit or using those projectiles to try and defend your turrets and stall this game out. Because, you know, as chaotic as it's gotten and as crazy as we are, you know, getting away with this one, that is still, the prime objective here for Immortals. Try and buy themselves some time. And if that Baron throw presents itself, be in place to jump on it.
Well, Hai usually very good at shot calling the Barons appropriately. He's aggressive at calling them, but he's also usually pretty accurate in calling them off. You expect FlyQuest to clean it up.
Especially when he's about to die from one Baron to auto in the air.
Shield me.
Probably time to abort mission.
Yep. See it again another time. Kills his enemy, the ward. Down it goes. Thanks for the 30 gold, pal.
Yeah. I mean, if we're trying to tally up, you know, comeback attempts here for Immortals, never mind. Let's for some more action. First,
tops off the Banshees, and Povel has to burn Flash to get away. Edge of Night Shield, I know it's not Banshees, but
he's got three people on his tail now. but 14 members.
Oop, hi, that's half his HP from a shock blast.
Moon wants it.
That happens again, it's gonna be bad for him. Exhaust is on, Pobok is still gonna be hit up. Ole tries to block out the curtain call. Quick shield in, and Ole one hit away from dead, but blocked by someone else. It's a Cody Sun face tanked it with Edge of Night Shield, so that was a zero summoner heal, I believe, to remove Deathfire Touch as an option for killing him off. But as many summoners down, looks like four of them burn on the side of Immortals. And FlyQuest still feel pretty good about this.
Yeah, the more that FlyQuest keep going for all these kills and blowing summoners, they increase the... Oh, actually, Dardock is pretty deep. There's Vision actually all around, but not Vision that saw Dardock get to this point. So even though there's a lot of FlyQuest members around!
Tries to get Hyde, Ward hop in, kicks him down, shut down, solo kill to Dardock, finally getting revenge from the very first play of the game. And the comeback tool starting to assemble. It's going to take a lot more.
I'm not sure what prohibited Balls from ulting. Maybe they made the call, hey, I don't need Stand United Shield, but it was pretty clear that you needed the Stand United Shield there, so maybe it's time to criticize the communication on FlyQuest.
I'm going to see if it was technically on cooldown for like that 1 second.
No, let's get our facts straight first.
No, pretty sure it was up.
He was doing blue buff.
Pretty sure it's all his fault.
Important business being taken care of in the jungle.
Yep.
Balls was farming wolf and blue.
Unlucky.
Tisk, tisk, tisk.
Yep. Oh, high shot calling, clearly slacking.
Yeah, I feel like those are the easiest calls to make, too. Help! Help!
Help! Ah, help me! Oh, well.
Right. As they continue to stall out, and they have gone, you know, for all these risky plays with their super high damage, squishy characters, start to get more and more gold back to this Immortals team. Immortals, as we said, do have a lot of long range damage.
Yeah. And it's a non-tank team. Right? Yeah. That's the really important thing. Oh, not non-tank. Sorry. Immortals were a non-tank team, you're right about that, sorry. FlyQuest, a lot of them are pretty squishy. There's only armor on two of the champions, so the heavy physical damage penetration can break through. Right now, it's not going to. Ocean Drake picked up. The sustain's going to be nice for FlyQuest.
Yeah. Let's see if they can pick someone off, because their siege is not the greatest, and the split push hasn't worked out, right? Balls has been toiling away in the side lanes, but there's the flank.
There we go, half HP flashes, Equalizer buys a lot of time, and Zonius is with the Flamesplitter facing. Balls drops down about two-thirds, Taunt's not gonna land, Dardock gets the shield, and now he's tanking up the curtain call. A few more seconds, they'll have a way back in, but look at those shields. Yeah, Balls shrugs off the rest of the damage, and they're gonna be okay on this one.
Defensive play here from Immortals is working out. Zonius completed now, so Flame has another option, even though did have to burn the flash. Some good damage dealt to FlyQuest as they're trying to exit. And Immortals are staying strong. Well, for how long?
Here comes the big play, looking for Pobok. They're dodging away, because the Black Shield buys a bit of time, but Exhaust is on, and that should be enough damage. One more shot, and here comes the chase in for Hyde. Dardock, nice top flash by Vol, secures that second kill. And now into the base they go, Immortals forced to run away, and yet again, this time with one of the Poke champions gone and the jungler dead, this could be a very easy Baron call for FlyQuest.
Well, they are going to go try and take advantage. Ball still has half-life on the Shen. The important thing is that they have Ocean Drake, and they're regenerating here, because tanking up the Baron would be fairly dangerous. The other thing is that there's no ultimate available for Flame yet. Rumble cooldown is coming up soon-ish, but not soon enough for the Baron contest.
Yeah, no real shot at this one. Maybe Cody Sun can look for the snipe, and there's always that chance that he does it right. Ward is there, charges it up, they're gonna wait it out.
Doo-doo.
They stop DPS, smart. Let him throw the piercing arrow, now burst it down. Really crisp, and it was a late smite, but it's good enough because there's no damage coming back through. That's as well as it could have been done by FlyQuest. Immortals did what they could, but no kills at the end.
All right, so attempt number two on the engagement in mid lane. They still have plenty available here as the exhaust is used there to chase down Pobelter. And Hyde's ultimate right back off cooldown. Able to keep up the chase here, take down the jungler. That's so huge when you go for these, as there was no Smite Steel available for Immortals. And as you said, they would have to rely on that arrow snipe being pretty lucky.
Turn for Ole to die. Quick Silver Sash use. Gets away from the dark binding. Now the snipe's into Cody Sun. Flashes still takes all the shots. Could hit one a little bit earlier and dodged away, but still he's forced into the fight. And that means Bin Inhibitor is the target. Pobelt are going to drop down. High caught again. Stand United this time does come off, and I will survive. Moon not going to take that one, I don't think. Dardock will. That's the inhibitor turret. The inhibitor itself going to fall right afterwards, and 5v4 going to be probably a quick reset for FlyQuest, and they'll get more right after.
Whew. Okay, inhibitor down, Baron buff on. This should be the FlyQuest return to their split, top and bottom. And as long as Balls gets out, yeah, no problem. No, not worth dying over red buff, so they should be able to run this one up past the side lanes here. Altec already getting in there to usher the minions along. Yeah, triple dragons, plus giant gold lead, plus Baron buff rolling through.
Good incremental gold leads, good incremental plays. Okay, two picks. Okay, this is a 99% Baron secure. Let's go for it. And they played it right to make sure it happened. All right, we have Baron. All right, let's go up the mid lane. Great, really easy to grab the inhibitor. They got that. Okay, let's reset.
Going for a hero play.
Oh, they got to try. High in the backline, lots of damage. Has to jump back, and he will get out soon enough. One kill picked off. Co-Walter very low. Moon looking for the kill. And he does get it. Shields keep him safe. On top of that one, Altec. Oh, Ooh. Looks for Dardak. Rooted up by Cody Sun and high. Now on the front line, looking for the shot. He's not going to land the snipe just yet. And Dardak will heal up, even though it's a 2-for-0. Oceanbreak going to regen them. Baron buff going to buff the minions. TP back in for Balls. And here comes a 5-man push to close the game out. And this should be it. No Ole, no Poe Belter. Curtain call could be just that for this game. Dardak tries to buy time in the front line. Not going to matter. Turret number one is gone. Turret number two going to be next on the menu. Somehow Immortals have to clear this one away. Declaws are not doing enough damage, but now the recalls, the respawns have come in. Nexus getting lower, the game gonna be closed out. They're trying to fight for, but it's gonna be the damage in for FlyQuest. 2-0, once again tying for second place. 5-1 to close out week three.
FlyQuest dream start to this season continues. And they are on course to meet up with Cloud9. This will be an extremely exciting
Phoenix One
confrontation.
Yep.
All three of those, you know, other teams that are at the top of the standings with them will be their next opponents. Exciting times and the real test there of the top of the LCS. Meanwhile, Immortals still continuing to struggle a bit and patch up quite a few issues.
Phoenix One into Cloud9, that's next week's matches here for FlyQuest. And those are very strong teams, of course. C9 undefeated in first place. Phoenix One only one match behind. It's definitely gonna be the real test right here because those squads have had to play against the league's best. FlyQuest has been like, it's like he's playing Mortal Kombat. You just go up the ladder and you play a progressively harder opponent every single time. 2-0 here, pretty solid over Immortals, who, you know, had an okay record. They had two match wins. It wasn't completely deplorable, but took care of business pretty well. They had a close game. They managed to snowball the way through. They had a game they blasted open the early game and did, you know, very similar things. Shot calling still crisp. The individual play from high, still very good as well. Moon, different build on Evelynn pretty much every single game, still finding ways to make it work. And the FlyQuest formula certainly is succeeding.
Yeah, and they've got a lot of these underdog hero stories on the team. Yep. The returning veterans, you know, that are old now, as well as Moon, who didn't have such a good time his first time around in the LCS and has completely changed history basically for himself here. It's actually just such a cool story, especially considering last time around, a lot of the flack that High would get would be small champion pool and, you know, lack of mechanics.
Can't lane well.
He had, previous to this game, probably should still remain true, the deepest champion pool, most diverse champion pool for any mid laner in the North American LCS. Mm-hmm.
Moon's still playing a ton of Evelynn, which is okay, right? Like, he's the only person playing this champion. You look at EVE's pro match history, it's just four Moon games.
He wasn't really a factor in this game at all.
No, this one wasn't about him.
It was almost all about that early play in mid lane, where we talked about Lee Sin going for the play on high, and high gets, you know, flashes blown for his opponent, gets first blood, gets double buffs. Sweet.
But the game was about high, then he started shot calling, let's get advantages in my lane, I'll break it through, and it worked out nicely. So, of course, congratulations to High and the rest of FlyQuest for the 2-0 win. But now, to get some thoughts on that win, let's hear from Pastry and FlyQuest carry the bot lane.
Thank you very much. I'm here with Altec after another successful weekend out for FlyQuest. Altec, you've had a fantastic weekend on a whole host of different lethality marksmen, Misfortune, Jhin. How have you adjusted to the metagame, and do you think it suits you?
Honestly, I like prefer playing like hyper carries a lot more, but I think like this is more of a team game, and champions like Jhin, who don't really need attack speed and stuff like that, they really benefit from this patch. So I think I've adjusted well to this patch.
I'd have to agree. And in general, I think FlyQuest kind of defying a lot of doubters moving into the season. You guys were underdogs moving in. And I think you look at the bottom lane, it doesn't feel like anything that special, but you've certainly proved them wrong now. How do you think you stack up against the competition, and particularly some of those top teams in their bot lanes you haven't played yet?
I think the strongest bot lane would be C9's bot lane, because obviously they're undefeated and they've been together for a long time. So I think they'll be the hardest challenge. But I think other than that, we should be able to like handle most of the bot lanes.
I have to agree, you guys have managed well. And of course, FlyQuest, you're now tied for second with TSM, really looking for those top spots. Do you think you guys can carry this throughout the rest of the season? And maybe, like, how far do you think FlyQuest can go? Is number one out of reach?
Obviously, I think number one's, like, our goal. But I think next week, since we're playing, like, C9 and P1, who are, like, the one and two, I think that'll be, like, the hardest weekend for us. And I guess that'll just, like, prove if we're, like, a top team or not.
And there is, of course, something a little extra special for you at the end of it, potentially. Making playoffs will be nice, but top four would secure a spot in Vancouver. I know that's a special place for you. What would it mean to kind of make it all the way there?
Honestly, it's like it's just playing in my hometown. Like, I've obviously thought about, like, playing in a final for once, but playing in, like, a final in my hometown, I think that'd be, like, the world to me.
Well, best of luck and congratulations on the weekend. Thank you very much, Altec. But we're going to move it back to the analyst desk to close out the weekend.
Thank you very much. Pace your time. FlyQuest here, 5-1 to close out week three, remaining in that second place slot right up there with TSM. That's got to feel good. And dominant game here. I mean, there's only so much to analyze when two kills go over to a Zed that early. Four kills, yeah, rather, go over to a Zed that early in the game.
I mean, you may as well just play the clips, because there's not like a ton to say.
This happened in both games, too, with the super early double kill going over to a carry on C9.
All right, well, let's take a look at the early kills handed over to High on this Zed, a champion that he is very familiar with from his old days in the LCS.
Right, I mean, you know, Dardoch is kind of the catalyst for Immortals, and whenever he doesn't get off the ground, they look like they struggle a lot. And here's a play where Dardoch goes over the wall, tries to make something happen, but isn't happy just with the flash, greeds out, unable to finish High off.
Great roam from Lemonation.
Great roam by Lemonation, double buffs on High now, and then falls as well, responding to the pressure mid. I mean, you know, FlyQuest as a unit always seems to collapse you exactly to support High.
Yeah, Balls was helping a lot at the end of that play.
He was
making
there.
Sure he could
moral
get away.
Support. You got it, guys.
So that's two kills right there, super early on in the game. Then 10:30, so just barely past that 10-minute mark, we have a 3-for-1 that goes in favor of FlyQuest. High picking up another two kills in this one. Take a look.
Yeah, this one was a little bit more chaotic because Immortals was like thinking about setting up a play, but they were just a little bit haphazard about the way they did this, and they missed a lot of skill shots mid-fight. Meanwhile, High's just landing all of his. Watch this Varus ultimate. I had to check if Flame was on the opponent team, because that's where it seemed to be.
Yeah, like it almost got the rumble.
Yeah, I mean, High did flash out of it because he was just completely in tune with this early game and just got incredibly fed.
Yeah, I mean, there's really not too much to say. You have a snowballing out of control Zed. We saw him continue to make plays, solo plays, roam plays down bottom. Like, he was all over the map after that. And we've seen High, you know, for years now on Zed, taking over games, happens once again.
Right. High is going to receive player of the game. I don't think that's going to come as a surprise to anyone. Now, another top performer on the team has been Moon, you know, this entire split. And in this game as well, had a very solid scoreline. Deathless for him. High, actually, highest deaths on the team. But that's okay when you're carrying. Well, yeah, exactly. Yeah. When you're carrying as hard as you are. But Moon is a player that I want to talk about. The Evelynn coming in, he's the only person playing this in the NALCS right now. This time, he actually went for a different build, more of that tanky. Not sure if it was the best idea. Yeah. Maybe they were just looking for a bit more of a frontline for the Zed. But
I mean, it's hard to know exactly why you would do that, because generally it's like the Eve goes in, gets a massive shield from her ultimate, does a ton of damage, you can't focus her, and then the Shen ult comes in when they want to start focusing her, and it's just you deliver this taunting, you know, bot basically in Balls. And when you build tankier, you're just harder to kill, but you didn't chunk them all out for the Jhin ult to snipe them out easier or the Zed to start cleaning up kills. So in that sense, you question a little bit, but because they're so far ahead, you can basically build any sort of productive item and probably still win.
And what I like about it is that they're trusting their legacy champion pools, because a lot of these players, especially High, we've said it's like 3.5 years ago he was playing Zed. It's been his best champion.
Right.
It's kind of in the meta. You can argue that you can play it. And Lemonation and ThinkGuard are doing a really good job in the draft, putting them in situations with which these champions can succeed, which is making it hard to prepare for them. Obviously, it's results-based. If these weren't working, we'd be like, they should just learn the meta picks.
That's very true.
But I do like it when this stuff works out.
You want to get in here?
Well, just real quick on the draft. I mean, I believe they flex the Jace mid after seeing the Zed pick, when Zed used to be a counter pick to Jace, and like the only person who made that look reasonable
was
like
not
Pawn,
a good flex.
Yeah, I didn't like Jace, that.
But the Zed was blind picked, essentially.
Yeah. Yeah, Zed was blind pick following the Morgana, and then the Rumble comes in and they flex Chase.
That's what I'm saying. It's like, I don't know why you would do that and just not pick something that you would prefer to play into Zed. I don't know why you'd want to play Jace into Zed.
Yeah.
It's a good question. We'll have to ask the Immortals players when we have an opportunity. But I want to kind of zoom out now real quick and just talk about FlyQuest moving forward. We talked about it after the C9 victory today. They will be playing each other next week. So we have a meeting between FlyQuest at 5-1 and C9 at 6-0. But there's some familiarity between these teams, which could make that matchup super interesting. Let's rehash that.
Yeah, the storylines are absolutely insane for this because to many people, high is C9. Lemonation's Notebook is a C9 notebook, not a FlyQuest notebook. So the history itself is there. And it's also a massive point for FlyQuest to prove themselves.
Right.
Because they have yet to play C9, TSM, and Phoenix One, arguably the other three top teams in the league. So they really have a lot of proving to do next week.
I mean, from a narrative perspective, absolutely. Also from a gameplay perspective, where, you know, C9 has some of the most standard, in a sense, drafts where they seem to always come out ahead, but they're playing exactly what they want to play. FlyQuest, on the other hand, absolutely crazy. No idea what these guys are going to do. Only ones doing what they're doing in the league, and you're going to have a total clash of styles in that sense.
It'll be very interesting to see how Reaper comes up against this FlyQuest draft, because we have, as you mentioned, looked at a lot of C9 drafts and said, oh, yeah, they're coming out with edges in every single one. Well, against FlyQuest, I don't know how you even begin to attack them in the draft. Let's go ahead and take a look at the players who stood out here in Week 3. Impact is going to walk away with the most accolades, 3 for the week. That's quite a lot, actually. Now, with Moon, Hansa, Ryu, and Svenskeren each netting 2 player of the games themselves. Of course, let's see how those performances affect the overall standings. Moon's strong week pushes him to first in total player of the game awards with Impact, Ryu, Svenskeren, and High hot on his tail. Did you think I would ever utter those words? Moon is leading player of the game. The tale of 2 splits for him.
Right.
Last split to this split, a total transformation.
Flabbergasted. Be a word.
Good word. That is a great word for it.
I can't follow up with a better word, so I'm not going to say anything.
Where's your thesaurus?
Yeah. Well, but then let's talk a little bit, too, about how we've even heard from the players themselves. Lemonation spoke about it, that, you know, that Moon has been a great solo queue player. He's always been a very solid individual player, but it's this roster, it's having a strong leader like High, who's able to put him in a place of comfortability where he can make stabs at big plays.
Mm-hmm. Well, and just confidence in the champ pool. We talk about that. It's been a little different than the rest of the LCS as well. And
he's put out the Nidalee and the Evelynn, right?
And Kindred, and he's trying stuff. And the fact that the team is willing to say, you can try that and we'll see how it goes, is a huge confidence boost for a player who historically has been in situations that are not the most comforting environments,
right.
I think.
Yeah.
So I think that's a huge boost, not just like High telling him what to do, but having the team's confidence in him.
Yeah, it's absolutely the case, because you look at previous splits and he has been a good solo queue player, but a completely different player on stage. So doing anything you can to increase his confidence really helps him.
A big step up for him. Let's take a look at how the teams are stacked up after this weekend. Cloud9 still in first place, while TSM and FlyQuest hold on to second. Meanwhile, Phoenix One drops to fourth, just above the middle of the pack teams. Then at the bottom of the table, Dignitas ends their week tied with Envy in 9th. We'll be back again next week with more North American LCS, starting Friday with Cloud9 versus Team Liquid, followed by Immortals versus Team Dignitas later in the Battle Arena. If that's not enough league coverage for you, make sure to tune in for the North American Challenger Series on Wednesday. But these two matchups here, Cloud9 versus Team Liquid, obviously gonna be the story of David and Goliath. We got Cloud9, a Team Liquid that has really been struggling to put together solid victories.
Right, but what's crazy is when you look at the standings, you think TL is doing so bad, and then they are tied for 5th. And
that's true.
I mean, I'm not going to say that they're going to beat Cloud9, but if they start picking up a couple more wins along the way, they're not looking in that bad a shape, considering that it seems to be very obvious groups of the top 4 and the rest of the league.
Yeah. Now, we've talked about trap games in the past, Jab, but do you really think that this is much of a trap game, considering that Cloud9 then faces FlyQuest later in that week? And that's definitely a more formidable opponent standings-wise.
Yeah, so it definitely is a trap game in the fact that you're very easily able to overlook them. Will they be trapped by Team Liquid? Another question.
Right.
I do not think they will.
Okay.
I think they will roll through them.
All right. Well, that's what I like to hear. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for us to head out. So for myself, the casters, and the entire live broadcast crew, thank you for watching, and we'll see you next week. Good night.